any scientific theory, the constants or the terms that we used can be classified into two groups. There are terms which are specific to the discipline under consideration. And for example, in arithmetic, the constants are terms denoting number, classes of numbers, relation between numbers, operations on numbers. In the last class, we have replaced variables by such constants to form sentences out of sentential functions. The second type of constants or terms that we are going to look at are terms which are common to every possible field of science. They are indispensable means of conveying human thought and for carrying out inference in any field of knowledge. So we will call these terms constants of a logical nature or logical character. Examples of such terms are, say, not, and, there exists, if, then, and so on. In this section, what we are going to do are to look at constants of this second type. So in English language, in grammar, they are called actually sentential conjunctions. The use of such terms is not specific to any particular discipline. Okay. In fact, establishing the usage of such terms is the fundamental part of any course of logic. And this is what is known as propositional logic or sentential calculus. So let us start with the term not. So let's start with negation of a statement. So suppose we are given a sentence or a statement P. The negation of the sentence P would be another sentence which has the exact opposite truth value to that of P. So if P is true to start with, negation of P should always be false. On the other hand, if P is false to start with, negation of P must always be true. Now, it should be kept in mind that negation doesn't mean opposites. So it's simply a sentence which has the opposite truth value. So if somebody says that the sentence that we are considering is, say, the number of tigers in India is greater than the number of lions, then the negation of this sentence should not be that the number of tigers is less than the number of lions. It should be that it's not the case that the number of tigers is greater than the number of lions, or the number of tigers is less than or equal to the number of lions. Okay. So one should keep in mind that negation doesn't always mean opposites. Okay. So a sentence and its negation are often together called contradictory sentences. Now, for simple sentences, creating a negation is simple. That you just have to insert the word not somewhere. Suppose we are given a sentence that New Delhi is the capital of India, then the negation of such a sentence would be simple. That you just put in the word not somehow, you say that it's not the case that New Delhi is the capital of India. That's a simple negation. However, negation becomes complicated when you have sentences which have quantifiers. So suppose we say that, think of a sentence with a universal quantifier. Say you say that all Indians speak Hindi. Okay. Now the negation of this will not be that some Indians speak Hindi. The negation of it will not be that no Indian speaks Hindi. The negation of this will be that there's at least an Indian who doesn't speak Hindi, or some Indians don't speak Hindi. Why is that the case? Why are the first two not, the first one not a negation of the original statement? So let's think of it. So we said that all Indians speak Hindi. If we say that some Indians speak Hindi, then when we say some, it also includes all. Okay? So obviously, both of them can be true at the same time. Similarly, if we say that the negation of all Indians speak Hindi is that no Indian speaks Hindi, both of them can be false at the same time. Okay? But we know that the negation should be such that whenever one is true, the other has to be false. Whenever one is false, the other has to be true. Okay? So therefore, we have to be very careful when we construct negations of sentences which have a quantifier. So for example, let's take the case of a sentence with an existential quantifier. So suppose the sentence Q is that some Indians are Hindu. This can also be written as there's at least one Indian who is a Hindu. Now, what is the negation of this? Okay, the negation of this is no Indian is a Hindu. Okay, this can be written in many alternative ways. You can say that no Hindu is an Indian. There does not exist an Indian who is a Hindu. But what is definitely not a negation of this sentence is that all Indians are Hindus. Okay. So you have to be very careful when you actually create negations of sentences with quantifiers. The other kind of logical constants that we are going to look at is the use of the word AND. Okay, so this is what is called a logical product. Okay, so when we have two simple sentences P and Q say, and we say P and Q, this is a this use of this word AND is over here a conjunction, and P and Q are called, or you can call it conjunction or a logical product, and P and Q are called factors of a logical product. Now the truth value of P and Q depends entirely upon the truth value of P and Q separately. And in logic, it's not necessary that the two sentences P and Q are related in form or content. So suppose I write a sentence that 2 into 2 is equal to 4 and New Delhi is the capital of India. Okay. Now if I write this sentence, the two sentences are not related in form or content in any way, the two simple sentences. But the truth value of the compound sentence or the conjunction would depend entirely upon the truth value of the first two sentences, or the two sentences that we have in the two simple sentences. Now, how do we write down the truth table for a conjunction? So suppose you have P, you have Q, and you have P and Q. Now, P and Q is true, the only case in which it can be true if both P and Q are true. Okay. On the other hand, irrespective of whether P is false or Q is false or both of them are false, the conjunction is going to be false. Okay. Similarly, so this is for the use of the word AND. The second logical so if I go back to the example that I said that if I write 2 cross 2 is equal to 4 and New Delhi is the capital of India, then what is the truth value of this sentence? This is a true statement. This is a true statement. Therefore, the final statement P and Q is also a true statement. Suppose I change this and I make this 2 in 2 is equal to 5 and New Delhi is the capital of India. This would be a false statement because the first part is false. And obviously, suppose I replace New Delhi by Mumbai, even then this will be a false statement. Okay. So finding out the truth value of a conjunction is quite easy. Similarly, let's look at the use of the word OR. So suppose I'm given a sentence P and a sentence Q, and there's a compound sentence that I've constructed P or Q, which can be written as this. Okay. Now, this is called as disjunction. The disjunction is always true if at least one of the constituent sentences is true. So it will be false only if both P and Q are false. If one of them is true, then this is true, and if both of them are true, then it's obviously true. Okay. So for example, if I wrote this sentence as 2 into 2 is equal to 5, or New Delhi is the capital of India, then what will be the truth value of this sentence? The first sentence is false, the second sentence is true, so when you're combining them by OR, the compound sentence has a truth value of T, or it's true. Okay. Now, in this context, one has to remember that the use of the word OR over here and the word OR in everyday language is a bit different. So in everyday language, OR is used in both the two ways. You can use it in an exclusive sense. You can use it in an inclusive sense. So when do we use it in an exclusive sense? For example, if we say, suppose someone says that you don't need a visa to enter Canada if you have a valid US visa or you have a Canadian passport. Okay. Now, in this case, if you have a valid US visa on a Canadian passport, obviously you will not be barred from entering Canada. So here the use of the word OR is in an inclusive sense, that both of them can be true at the same time. Whereas if I say that, if someone says that Ambedkar was born in Maharashtra or in Karnataka, then here it excludes the possibility. When you're actually stating this statement, it means that he was either born in Maharashtra or in Karnataka. So the both of them cannot be simultaneously true. And this is something that is that you understand when you hear the statement. Okay. However, in logic, whenever we use or, we use it in an inclusive sense, which means that when I say P or Q, it means P or Q or both. Okay. That is something that you have to keep in mind, that in logic, we always use or in the inclusive sense. Okay. The last thing that we look at is the use of the constants if and then, a logical constants of a logical character if and then. So suppose you have two statements, simple sentences, that one is a natural number and you have another sentence that one is a real number. Suppose these are two simple sentences, P and Q. And suppose I combine them by if and then. So if I say if one is a natural number, then one is a real number. Okay. This kind of a compound sentence is something that is called an implication. The subordinate clause or the thing that's attached to if is something that is called the antecedent. And the principal clause is that is attached to then is something that is called the consequent. Now, the truth value of an implication depends entirely upon the truth value of the antecedent and the consequent. So, suppose you have P, Q, and P implies Q. So, suppose both of them are true. The antecedent is true, the consequent is true, then the implication is true as well. Suppose the antecedent is false, then we don't even need to look at what the truth value of the consequent. Okay? So it's true as well. The only situation when an implication can be false is when the antecedent is true and the implication is false. Then the implication is false. So these two cases, when the antecedent is true, and that's what antecedent is false, and that's what make the implication true, are situations which we call situations that are vacuously true. Okay. So these are the three constants that we have, three kinds of compound sentences that we have looked at. We have looked at implication, we have looked at conjunctions, we have looked at disjunctions. Okay. In all the three cases, we have found out that the truth value of the compound sentences depend on the truth value of the constituent simple sentences. So in the rest of the course, we will try to look at how to find out laws of sentential calculus. So for example, if I write down a sentence like P and Q implies P, is this true irrespective of what sentences we place and put in the place of P and Q? So if that's true, irrespective of what we place in the place of P and Q, we get something that is a law of sentential calculus. And we find out whether that's true using a technique that we call truth tables, which we are going to do in a different lecture.